Satoshi's cheat 1.3. So we already discussed how Satoshi solved the consensus problem by enabling or basically structuring rules in such a way that nodes need to follow the longest chain. Did Satoshi actually solve the Byzantine general problem? That's what we will discuss, as well as basically the new invention that Satoshi managed to do so, the digital time stamping. So let's dive into the next slide. As you know already now, is that a ledger can be seen as a record or recordings with a historical background structured by rules. Rules used to be opposed by centralized parties. So the centralized entities, the people controlling those entities, a person or a department or a government, basically a ruler, imposed the rules on the ledgers and therefore the entities, the people in those ledgers. Now all of a sudden we have no ruler. So we have rules, but we don't have a ruler. So we replaced the ruler and we shove forward a mathematical software protocol. So we basically invented a new form of governance, already discussed. So by removing the ruler, we also created a new form of trust. Now we don't trust in a higher authority, which basically is a bit programmed, which is a bias or a wrong error in our, bias in our judgment as humans. We always need to strive towards a higher authority. But in this case, we actually invented something that we can trust without a higher authority. So it's a new trust model. Hence, a blockchain is sometimes also called a trust machine. Since it generates trust, I can interact with somebody without trusting that person, without even knowing that person. It's neutral, right? So no gender preferences, no skin of the color preferences, religion, sexual preferences, et cetera, right? So we've got a new form of ledger with a new form of rules without an authority, which also can start programming itself. Quite interesting, right? Okay, so as you already probably most likely caught, but what's very important, which I remind you all here once more, is that a different set of rules will lead to a different form of consensus, which will lead to a different type of blockchain. So a different set of rules will lead to a different blockchain. Because if you tweak the rules a bit, you will tweak the blockchain a bit. It's just like when you see a blockchain as a huge machine. If you add some new stuff, if you remove some new stuff, if you impose new rules on it, it will do different things. It can't do the things it previously could, but perhaps it can do other things. A good example of this, of course, is the Ethereum spin-off where in 2014 of Bitcoin. Well, not an entirely new spin-off, of course, or not a spin-off, but an entirely new type of blockchain with a lot more flexibility, but it therefore could do a lot more things, but also because it changed, it can't do other things. As mentioned before, different blockchains, different use cases. So different ledgers, different set of rules, or different set of rules, different ledgers. You now also know how nodes stick to the single source of truth. As Anders has beautifully shown you, is that by reading one single hash, you can instantly see the entire transaction history, or whether the entire transaction history is altered or whether it's exactly the same with every letter, every single bit and byte is included. As long as nobody alters the history, the same hash will result. So in an instant, in a snap of a finger, you will know that you have the exact same truth as a node on the other side of the world, which in my world was quite mind-blowing for the very first time. But then again, I also saw this for the very first time. Although that's not entirely true, I did some auditing in the past as a certified auditor, as we say it in English. And what we use this in companies as well, when we make a hash total of, for example, payment batches. So if you work in a company and if you sometimes pay invoices, you also see these cryptographic forms returned. Also, of course, in the internet protocol and many other forms of life, as you already seen. So Satoshi's rule, Satoshi's cheat, was follow the longest chain, right? So, in other words, we now have the longest chain principle, where Satoshi basically says the truth is that chain that is the longest, as discussed before. But is that truly a solution of the Byzantine general problem? Think about it for a second. Does the general know in an instant, hey, that's the truth. That's the truth I can follow. Take 10 seconds for that one. No, he doesn't. The node doesn't know whether that's exactly the truth. Why? Because he could be watching at a purple block or at a black block. You don't know at that singular moment that's the truth. You need to wait. You need to wait it out for at least 10 minutes, because that's when the new block gets composed. And that's when you know, okay, perhaps my purple block was only a single block and I followed the wrong blockchain, right? So I was in a temporary fork, as I will show you later on. So I need to follow the other blockchain. To be sure, one block is not sufficient. Nowadays, it's recommended to wait at least 3, but on average 6 blocks. Of course, 6 block was mostly something from the past, because that currently, because the hash power has grown tremendously, the common consensus says, okay, you should wait. Three blocks is decent. It hardly occurs that 3 blocks gets erased and people shift to the other chain. And keep or remind this one, of course, as a user, it really doesn't matter, because your transaction is already or most likely included in one of the other blockchains. So whether in the purple block or in the black block, as a user, it doesn't matter. But as a node, of course, it does matter, because as a node, you will have a different hash. And I will challenge you once more. Why does the hash of a purple block is different than the hash of the black block? What is the one thing differently in the block mined by miner A than a valid block, both are valid blocks, than a valid block by miner B? What's the one thing different in those blocks? Indeed, the coin-based transaction. The transaction where the miner will send the mining reward to their own wallet, right? So Satoshi didn't solve the Byzantine general problem. If somebody transfers me 10 Bitcoin or 10,000 Bitcoin, actually in 22 May of 2010 or 2011, 10,000 Bitcoin was once paid for 2 pizzas. Let's say if somebody sent me 10,000 Bitcoins now and says, hey, Jordi, bake me a pizza, then I don't know whether I actually received the 10,000 Bitcoins. I need to wait it out. I need to wait for at least 10 minutes to see if that unconfirmed transaction that he sent to me is actually confirmed in the first block. And then, even then, I'm not entirely sure, will that block last? Is it a purple block or is it in the main chain in a black block? Right? Even then, I need to wait it out. Of course, that's very impractical, because this person would really like to have a pizza and would not like to wait for at least 30 minutes, right? So with small payments, it's perfectly fine to accept the risk. And of course, they're not going to pay me 10,000 Bitcoins anymore, but more of a few Satoshis. But in the end, it's all about a matter of perspectives. So when you start sending money from a peer-to-peer when you're buying your groceries, yes, waiting 30 minutes is a very, very long time. But when you send money to your mother in Ghana, or a colleague of mine sends money to his mother in Cameroon, or another one to his parents in Indonesia, then 10 or 30 minutes is very fast. And then, of course, the amount of transaction fee, 10 cents or 20 cents, is insanely cheap when you compare it with, for example, a Western Union with at least 7 to 15% per transaction. And there you need to wait, you need to get in line, etc. We will discuss into that later. So it's all about a matter of perspective. And the current use case of Bitcoin is, of course, the neutral, decentralized money. But more importantly, it's borderless, and you can actually send it within a certain amount of certainty that it will be received within 10 minutes on the other side of the world, without an intermediary. So, yes, Satoshi managed to solve the Byzantine general problem. Did he, she, or they actually solve it? No, it's a practical approach. So you can read all about it, in, as you can see in the next slide. In the original white paper, we will update it in the further readings. What we will also do, and take your time there, for example, if you go to the loo, if you have 10 minutes of your spare time, we will do a very interesting link there, the history of Bitcoin, where you can actually see the first time where the white paper is published. I think it was in October 2018, and where the first block, the Genesis block, was mined, which was the 3rd of January 2019, and then you will see gradually all the new things happening. So the increasing in difficulty of the proof of work after after half a year, the first Bitcoin transaction, did the pizzas come by? That's a really interesting link, further reading. So bottom line here is Satoshi created a new form of ledger, increasing transaction cost efficiency. As we've seen, of course, it now costs you 10 cents and 10 minutes to send transactions across the world instead of at least three to five working days, if you're lucky, and 10 to 15%. So Satoshi didn't do this all by himself. He used, of course, he combined, let's say it's a he for just as a personification for me. He combined several techniques. Like the cryptographic security already existed, the proof of work, of course, already existed, because proof of work is used in the internet protocol to prevent spam, as you've seen in one of the short movies, or if you will see in upcoming movie. What Satoshi did add, though, is the consensus rules, right? So you can't make more than 21 million bitcoins, the halvening each 4 years, the longest chain protocols, right? So he shoved down the ruler and created a mathematical set of rules which we currently follow in the Bitcoin Core protocol. If you think those rules are bullshit, if you don't think the monetary policy should be a deflationary policy, if you think that a block size should be a 2 MB, so you could do twice the amount of transactions, feel free to just fork the entire Bitcoin blockchain and create your own blockchain. Bitcoin Cash, for example, created a fork 2 years ago, and they started to create bigger blocks because they believe that that would result into a better vision of Satoshi's white paper. And people have been starting to fork it, fork Bitcoin, create new parameters, create new consensus rules. All of a sudden, since 2008, thousands of new projects, new experiments, have been popping out in the world. It's incredibly amazing. I even get starting to stutter here. So important here is to know that when you have a longest chain, you need to have a sequence, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, currently almost 600,000 blocks. This sequence therefore equals time. Once more, this sequence therefore equals time, because it's time. Now, in a digital world, we can do all kinds of different things. As we will see, I will skip a slide here and another one. For example, the block numbering is leading. Not the real world time, no, the block numbering is leading. That's the order of transactions. Because you order the transactions in a certain sequence, you order history. It's very important to realize it, because you order transactions in a block and you order the blocks, you order history, you create a storyline, you create a certain story in a transaction, right? And why is this so important? Why do you need to realize that by inventing this gathering of transactions and sequence of blocks, it now makes digital time available in space, creating scarcity. You can now actually send stuff along the internet without copying it. Like transferring value from person A to B, because you now have a moment in time that you can say, hey, then I didn't have it, now I do have it. And that wasn't possible with the internet. Of course, you do have a time clock in the right bottom of your screen or on your phone somewhere, but that's centralized time. And of course, you can alter that time, etc. A very interesting example of this, I always love to harass my students with this movie, is the movie Ready Player One. We will upload it in the, or we will give it in the further reading or further viewing list. But in that movie, you actually see what digital time can encompasses. You can actually recreate an entire world because you now have time. Without time, without a fixed amount of time, which you can't, which is immutable, right? That's the most important part here of the time. Because it's protected by the amount of proof of work, you can't alter time. You can't. You can't alter history. Of course, you can try to steer the future with some forms of attack, like the 51% attack, as we will discuss later on. But the most important, since you can't alter the past, as we've seen in the Honest movie, because it's visible and it's not doable because of the amounts of proof of work, because you can't alter the past, and because you have a sequence in transactions, you now have digital time, and now you can start creating all kinds of new software businesses, and you can actually create entirely new worlds. And therefore, I do think that the gaming industry will be one of the first industries to pick this one up, as shown in Ready Player One, trying to recreate Ready Player One without decentralized digital time, without time that you can't mute. So, I will see you in two and a half hours when you watch this this awesome movie. If you don't like it, let me know as well. But I most sincerely enjoyed it. And also, think about this moment. Think about this question I have you. In the movie, the main player, I forgot his name, and I will my team member will harass me for this one. He has a cubicle, the cubicle with all the colors, and then he actually returns time. Try to imagine how that works in a blockchain. What's happening there? How is he able to return time for only a short amount of time? If you know the answer, let us know. I will most likely forget to mention it in the next video, but let us know in the comments if you have discussions, and especially, why is this so interesting, and is this technically possible? What's your vision? See you in the Slack. Otherwise, see you in the next video.